Reverend Joe Rogers is here with me, and we will be offering virtual worship each week. Sometimes it will be both of us, other times just one of us. To begin, we will share the worship service. Jill is a retired ordained minister who served at Courtright Sixth Line Pastoral Church. So we welcome you to our worship service this morning and pray that you will find it meaningful. For the next 4 weeks, we will be looking at the theme of fear and how it was addressed in the Bible.
Let's take a moment now to open our hearts to prayer. Let us pray. O God, Creator, Redeemer, and Friend, grant us your mercy and grace. Roll the stone of our world's despair away. Through your love and the love of our Lord Jesus Christ, give us the assurance of a world renewed, not in our time, but in your time. Give us the patience and courage we must all have to wait, to fill our empty cups once more with hope, to find faith in you and your creation. Amen.
Nice. Our scripture reading today comes from Psalm 55, verses 1 to 7. Give ear to my prayer, O God. Do not hide yourself from my supplication. Attend to me and answer me. I am troubled in my complaint. I am distraught by the noise of the enemy because of the clamor of the wicked. For they bring trouble upon me, and in anger they cherish enmity against me. My heart is in anguish within me. The terrors of death have fallen upon me. Fear and trembling come upon me, and horror overwhelms me. And I say, oh, that I had wings like a dove. I would fly away and be at rest. Truly, I would flee far away. I would lodge in the wilderness. I chose this scripture to begin our sermon series on the theme of fear because it captures what fear feels like. My heart is in anguish. Fear and trembling come upon me. We have all experienced times in our lives when we have been in fear. Maybe it has been because of a diagnosis about our health that was frightening. Maybe it has been about a broken relationship and we have been unable to mend it and have been fearful about the impact of that on our lives and the lives of those we love. Maybe it has been about making a difficult decision. All of these situations evoke fear in us. What does fear feel like? As the psalmist wrote, anguish and trembling. Great anxiety accompanies fear. Avoidance is one response to fear. The psalmist wishes that he has wings like a dove so that he can fly away and be at rest. We don't like living in the fear, and we want to escape it. The problem is, when we return, the situation is still there, waiting for us, and we have to deal with it at some point. But oh, how nice it would be to escape it and not have to face it and not have to make decisions around it. So what do? We turn to God. The psalmist is asking God to listen and to answer. I believe that God always listens to our prayers. I also believe that God answers in God's own time and way. Sometimes the answers we seek are not the answers we are given. So often we don't recognize the answers because we are seeking different answers. We don't know why this pandemic has taken over our lives in 2020. I don't believe God has caused this pandemic, but I do believe that God is aware of our response to the pandemic. Some people are playing it down, saying it's just like any other flu bug. Obviously, that is not the case. Others are ignoring the protocols set out by our healthcare professionals. Maybe there isn't hard and true evidence that wearing masks and social distancing work, but I'd rather do that than ignore such advice. There are still others who haven't left their homes since March for fear of bringing COVID into the home and infecting those with more fragile health. All of these things are personal choices. But it is also a choice to live in fear. I choose not to. Not just about this, but also about other aspects of my life, like whether or not I want to live in fear of getting cancer again, or whether or not I'll enter a restaurant or store, or whether or not I will visit people in person, or go to funeral homes, or bury people. I avoid social situations, and if I am in a situation where I do not feel safe, I leave. I choose to live my life in the midst of this pandemic with an ear to what is reasonable, but not to live in fear. I pray God to help me make the correct decisions about what to do. Though it sounds tempting to be like the psalmist and flee the situation, the reality is that there really is nowhere to flee. Everywhere we go, COVID is there also. It's good to get away, to have a change of scenery, but it is also important to remain safe. We do not throw caution to the wind, but we trust in God, and we trust that others are following the safety protocols as well. We pick and choose who we will be around. Throughout my life, I have chosen to be happy. There have been situations that have thrown me into unfamiliarity, but I trust in God and I choose happiness. We cannot always choose how things will go in our relationships, in our environment. Wild forest fires are not a situation which people choose, but to live in fear is not the answer. Listen to what the officials are saying and heed their warnings. Flooding from hurricanes is not a situation that people choose, but they have the choice to leave behind their material things in order to save their lives. I suppose our choices are based on our priorities. What is our treasure? Is it our homes or is it something else? My priority is the people I love. My priority is my relationship with God. Do we just give lip service to our faith, or do our actions demonstrate that we live by faith? The psalmist acknowledges his fear and turns to God. The last sentence in Psalm 55 is, "But I will trust in you." That is what I will choose. I will trust in God. Will you? Thanks be to God. Amen.
Rather than a response to Marilyn's thought-provoking reflection, I'd like to offer a moment of levity. And this story is called Pecans in the Cemetery. On the outskirts of a small town, there was a big old pecan tree just inside the cemetery fence. One day, two boys filled up a bucket full of nuts and sat down by the tree out of sight and began dividing them up. One for you, one for me. One for you, one for me, said one boy. And several dropped and rolled down toward the fence. Another boy came riding along the road on his bicycle. As he passed, he thought he heard voices from inside the cemetery. He slowed down to investigate, and sure enough, he heard, "One for you, one for me, one for you, one for me." He just knew what it was. He jumped back on his bike and he rode off in great fear, and just around the bend, he met an old man on a cane hobbling along. "Come here quick," said the boy. "You won't believe what I heard. Satan and the Lord are down at the cemetery dividing up the souls." The man said, "Really? Stop it, young man. Can't you see it's hard for me to walk?" But when the boy insisted and looked so frightened, the man hobbled slowly to the cemetery. And standing by the fence, they heard, "One for you, one for me. One for you, one for me." The old man whispered, "Boy, you've been telling me the truth. Let's see if we can peek in the fence and see the Lord." And shaking with fear, they peered through the fence, yet were still unable to see anything. The old man and the boy gripped the wrought iron bars of the fence tighter and tighter as they tried to get a glimpse of the Lord. And at last they heard, "One for you, one for me. let's go get those two nuts by the fence and we'll be done here. They saw the old man made it back to town a full 5 minutes ahead of the boy on the bike. You see, fear is an incredible master. It controls our emotions and even our physicality. Let not our imagined fears lead us to distraction and anxious hearts, but find peace and comfort in the knowledge that God is with us always. Amen.
Calling for
this space together today. And so remember this, as you go, may you know the love of God, the peace of Christ, and the acknowledgement of the Holy Spirit with us and for us.